Please start, Priyanka.
Good afternoon, my respected faculties and my dear colleagues. I'm going to present a case. My patient is a 25 years old gentleman, Hindu, student by profession and resident of Jalgaon, Maharashtra. He presented with swelling in both sides of the neck for last 6 months, swelling in both axillae for last 6 months, and fever for last 3 months. The patient was apparently well 6 months back, and the swelling was incidentally felt by the patient, which was initially around 1 centimeter in size, which appeared on the right upper side of the neck, and it gradually increased to attain the present size of about 2 into 2 centimeter. And afterwards, he started developing multiple swellings on the both sides of the neck. It was not associated with any pain or discharge. Patient also complained of similar swellings on both sides of the axilla, which appeared 6 months back. It was also initially small, about 1 centimeter in size, which gradually increased and progressed to involve the bilateral axilla. There are no other swelling in the other part of the bodies, like groin, back of the knee, or around the elbow. There is no ulcer or discharge from the swelling. The patient underwent an excision biopsy of the swelling on the right side of the neck 10 days back. So the episodic, which was persisting for around 10 to 14 days with a febrile period in between. It was recorded up to 101 degree centigrade, Fahrenheit. There was no chills and rigors. Patient gave a distressing history of night sweat, which caused him to wake up. And there was no asserted joint pain, skin rash at the onset of the fever. Patient gave a history of loss of appetite and weight loss about 10 kgs in last 3 months. So patient gave no history of pain and fever preceding the swelling, no ear pain, deafness, or running nose. No history of hoarseness of voice, dyspnea or dysphagia, no chest pain, cough or hemoptysis, no abdominal pain, abdominal distension, swelling, jaundice, hematemesis, no loin pain, hematuria, no loss of consciousness, convulsion or headache, no symptoms pertaining to any cranial nerve injury, or no weakness of the limbs. The patient is no known medical or surgical ailment in past, no history of contact with tuberculosis or any hypertension or diabetes mellitus. Patient is unmarried, consumes a non-vegetarian diet, and there is no history of any high-risk behavior. Family history, parents are alive, no history of similar malignancy or any neck swelling in the family. Summary. So in my summary from history, I have a 25 years old gentleman who is presenting with a swelling in the neck and axilla for 6 months, which were initially a very small size, about 1 into 1 centimeter, and it afterwards it became multiple, involving both the sides, and it attained a size of 2 into 2 centimeter. Patient also complained of a fever for last 3 months, which is persisting for 10 to 14 days with a febrile period in between. It is not accompanied by any chills and rigors. The ailment is accompanied by night sweat with loss of appetite and significant weight loss. There is no other systemic symptoms.
What do you make out of your summary? What exactly is your case based on history alone?
Based off my history, my patient is a young adult with like rapidly increasing swelling on both sides of the neck and with fever. So I will like to keep my differentials as a lymphoma or any tuberculosis.
So you think it's the lymphatic system which is involved presently? That's all we were interested in.
Yes,
the most common swelling in the neck is?
Tuberculosis.
What is the most common swelling in the neck?
Lymph nodes.
What's the most common cause of this lymph node swelling?
The most common cause is it's reactive. After that, it's tubercular.
So if you read the Western books, the most common swelling in the neck is the lymph node. And the most common cause of lymph node enlargement, in the West they say malignancy, but in this part of the world, tuberculosis. Others would just follow. So by and large, you're looking at a lymphatic system. And you think it is involving this is the case of, to you, generalized lymphadenopathy, because there are nodes at the other sides also. That's what you're thinking? Anything you want to ask in the history?
About the constitutional symptoms, what you have asked, you have written here. What is specifically about the fever you asked?
Sir, about the fever, I asked him about the onset of the fever. Like whether it was associated with any joint pain or skin rash. I asked about the duration of the fever, when it is coming, when it is going, and whether it is accompanied by any sweating, it is reducing on its own, or patient has to...
No, what is specific about for tuberculosis? There is some diurnal variation?
Yes, sir. In tuberculosis, we usually find an evening rise of temperature, which is not a high grade. It's a low grade fever, and it subsides on its own with sweating.
And your patient, this was not the history. It was not like this in your patient.
Sir, my patient gave a history. It was not a typical evening rise of temperature. It came. It had a diurnal variation, but it was not a evening rise of temperature as such. And it was sometimes it was recorded up to 100, 101. It was
there was there. How do you? What is the cause of night sweats in these patients? You know, there's the evening rise of temperature and night sweats. You often, I mean, I'm just asked. Priyanka, you presented well. Your history is good. So that's why I'm asking you this question. What is the usual basis for this night sweats?
I don't know.
Anybody? Yes. Can you just hold the mic? No, not the evening rise of temperature. Night sweats, I'm asking. Now, there is an extension to that. Most of the patients of tuberculosis in the past belong to very low socioeconomic status, and they would be laborers working. And as he rightly said, they appreciate only when they're back and there is evening rise of temperature. And when it dropped, they had sweats. So they would have evening rise of temperature with night sweats. So this is one feature which is more or less disappeared now, because you get tuberculosis so rampantly all around that they may not have a classical presentation all the time. If you get one, you may not get the other. But the fact that you have night sweats, the temperature must be rising in the evening sometime. I was just taking a leaf out of that. So do look for that. And now you're saying there was up to 100 degrees. So evening rise of temperature is an important feature, but so are the night sweats, which appear when the temperature drops. They don't have temperature in the night. Okay. Let's go to the examination now. You want to
what are the other constitutional symptoms you want to look at, other than this fever, joint pain, and rash?
So other constitutional symptoms, this includes cough, hemoptysis. My patient already has anorexia and weight loss. And
would you like to know about the itching also?
So I wanted to know about itching, but my patient did not give any history of itching.
There was no history of itching?
No, sir.
Why did you take that history?
Sir, itching is most commonly seen in the disease pertaining to the lymphoreticular system.
Is it itching all the time? Is it itching mostly?
They get
pain along the lymph nodes, and then they have a tendency to scratch. But there is limited areas of itching. Where do they get their itching? How is it very? It's a very specific finding. On the trunk.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
So on general physical examination, my patient was examined in a well-lit room after taking due consent with exposure up from the neck to the nipple line. Patient was conscious, oriented, alert, and with a Karnofsky score of 80. Pulse was 80 per minute, normal and regular, and volume tension. Blood pressure was 110 by 72 millimeter of mercury taken in the right arm. Respiration is 15 per minute. Patient was affable on examination. Patient was nutritionally not preserved on account of paler. And patient had a BMI of 20. On now coming to the examination of the neck, on inspection, multiple swelling on both sides of the neck. It was mostly involving the level 2, 3, 4, and 5, variable sizes of 1 to 3 centimeter. The swelling, they had a smooth surface with regular margin, no venous prominences over the neck and the thorax, the overlying skin scar mark was present. There was no dilated veins, no swelling seen in the thyroid region. On palpation, temperature of the neck was normal. There was no tenderness. Multiple enlarged node on both sides of the neck on 2, 3, 4, and 5 with a varying size of 1 to 3 centimeter was palpated, which was very discrete and globular with a smooth surface and distinct margin, soft in consistency, mobile, with no skin fixity. There was no fluctuation, no pulsation. Trachea was in the midline. Common carotid artery pulsation was normal. The thyroid gland was not palpable. Examination of the axilla. On inspection, multiple swelling was visible on both sides of the axilla, which had a globular shape with variable size, smooth margin with a regular margin. Overlying skin was normal, no venous prominences. Temperature was normal, no tenderness. Multiple nodes were palpable over the anterior, posterior, central, and lateral group of both sides. And it was a varying size of 1 to 2 centimeter, discrete globular smooth surface, small soft consistency, mobile. And I palpated the anterior group along the anterior axillary fold, the lateral group along the lateral, like the shaft of the humerus. Central group, I placed my finger, pushed up, and the posterior group was along the posterior axillary fold. I have examined the drainage site scalp for any wound or any infection. In the oral cavity, I examined for the Waldeyer's ring, tongue, buccal mucosa, nasopharynx, tonsils, head and nasal cavity, paranasal sinuses, thyroid, and other lymph nodes, including inguinal group of lymph nodes, epitracheal, and popliteal group of lymph nodes. General physical examination abdomen, there was no organomegaly, abdomen was soft and elastic, and respiratory, cardiovascular, and CNS was normal. So in my summary, I have a 25-year-old gentleman presenting with a swelling in the neck and axilla for last 6 months, with a history of fever for last 3 months, with accompanied by night sweats with loss of appetite and weight loss. On examination, patient has a Konofsky score of 80 with paler. An examination of hair of neck and axilla, multiple mobile discrete lymph nodes of variable size of 1 to 3 centimeter with soft consistency palpated on both sides of the neck and the axilla. Systemic examination is essentially normal. So it's a case of generalized lymphadenopathy with means probably etiology of lymphoreticular malignancy.
Any questions, sir?
Why directly you are saying it is a lymphoma or lymphoreticular malignancy? Why it is not a tuberculosis?
Sir, I would like to keep a differential of tuberculosis. And but my patient, I asked, but in this case, for not having tuberculosis, I asked for any contact with tuberculosis. The patient did not have. And the patient has a very typical pale abstinent type of fever. I asked for any evening rise of temperature followed by patient did not have, and also I asked for cough, hemoptysis, and
in examination.
And in examination, sir, the field, the lymph nodes, they were very discrete with prominent margins and globular in shape with a soft consistency. Whereas in tuberculosis, in lymph nodes, we mostly find matting with no, like the margins are not regular. And
Priyanka, what are the points against lymphoma here?
Points in favor of lymphoma?
Against.
Sir, against lymphoma, I have that this patient has no history of any pruritus, no history of any bony pain. In abdominal examination, there is no organomegaly. And
this is it a Pelep stain, classical Pelep stain?
Sir, a classical
which is bimodal periodic pattern, okay.
A classical Pelep stain fever is a high-grade fever which comes at a duration like which stays for 5 to 7 days with apparential period of 10 to 14 days in between. It's recorded up to 38 degrees centigrade. And
is that the fever here?
Sir, the fever is, there is a fixed afebrile period in between and with no chills and rigors.
Your patient has night sweats almost every day.
Yes, sir.
And I'm not ignoring it because that's not normal. And up to 100 every day.
Yes, sir.
The patient has fever.
Yes, sir.
And this is not Pelep stain. Okay?
Yes, sir.
The fever pattern goes in favor of an inflammatory pathology. So tuberculosis looks likely. That's why they are asking you.
Yes,
simply because the nodes are not matted, you can't rule out tuberculosis. You know what we are saying.
Hmm.
Now, just because it could not be, it's possible that it may be lymphoma. I'm not saying that because the characteristic of lymph nodes is very much like lymphoma. But tuberculosis cannot be ruled out easily.
Yes, sir.
So it would be safer. Is there anything else which goes in favor of lymphoma here? Is there significant weight loss?
There is a significant weight loss of 10 kgs in the last 3 months.
That can happen
with tuberculosis also.
Yes.
And that's right. And they're so similar in their presentation.
Yes,
I mean, nobody can say that it is just this.
Yes.
Therefore, it would be safer to have both included in one breath.
Okay.
Yes, Dr. Ratna. Can you give the mic, please?
Very characteristically, she has described that all the lymph nodes that are palpable are soft in consistency. In tuberculosis, with so many lymph nodes that are palpable, they'll all be in different stages of development.
We are just trying to make it into a situation where the question was raised. You should be able to entertain both.
Yes, sir.
Isn't it? And why go even otherwise? They're not matting. The nodes are not, they're discrete, mobile. Mm. It goes in favor of a lymphoma. But then they're all asking for the symptoms also. Mm. There are constitutional symptoms which are suggestive. And also, it's such a common disease in this part of the world. So everybody will ask you this question. Now, how do you bail yourself out of that situation? The case, rather than saying anything else, can you go to the diagnosis? I'll just help you with that. It's a case of generalized lymphadenopathy in a 25-year-old gentleman with possibility of lymphoma and also tuberculosis. You like that? It's easier.
Yes, sir.
Now you discuss the case. Nobody makes a diagnosis simply based on what you have said. You would also investigate this patient.
Yes.
And everybody is sensible enough to know that they are both coexisting also many a times. You can have both of them in one patient. It's so common a disease. So therefore, keep that option open for discussion. Otherwise, this question is going to come.
Yes.
I'm simply taking an extension of that question. He asked you, why can't you entertain tuberculosis? Because there's some features of tuberculosis also there.
Mm.
Some are not there, but there are others. Okay. So, I would like to entertain both. And although you have seen this patient, we haven't, and we believe what you're saying, but even in lymphoma, you don't get them exactly like similar. And they're not always rubbery, discrete,
yes,
which
sir.
People describe often.
Mm.
They try to become firmer and harder very, very quickly, unless it is a pure early Hodgkin's, which is very, very rare. And the commonest lymph nodes involved in Hodgkin's?
Cervical.
So you don't get all this kind of picture, so one has to read carefully what you're presenting. How do you proceed to now? Any question, anybody? Because generalized lymphadenopathy, we've kept it absolutely based on examination. Generalized lymphadenopathy, metastasis of unknown primary. These are scenarios that we've got here. Any question? Okay. How do you proceed?
So I'm keeping both lymphoma and tuberculosis.
You're not happy with that?
Yes, sir.
You're safer, no?
Yeah.
And in the exam, be very defensive.
Yeah.
Only when he has agreed with you, then you can go on offensive. Presently, both are possible. Okay.
So I will like to do some investigations to confirm my diagnosis. So for that, I will like to do a complete blood count. In that, I will like to see the lymphocytosis, the peripheral smear. And after that, I will like to do a ultrasonography of the neck and the axilla to look for the character of the lymph nodes, and followed by, I would like to do an excision biopsy of the lymph node.
Can you simply do an FNAC? Most examiners come from the same kind of institution, the one they're working in. So what they would do, they'll expect. I have nothing wrong, I have no problem. Ultrasound is a good thing to do, to know the characteristic of the lymph nodes. And will FNAC be fine? You're saying biopsy because you have lymphoma in mind. Suppose you do FNAC, it picks up tuberculosis, then you got both in mind now. So,
although FNAC can be done, but if I do a excision biopsy.
What do you normally do, Priyanka, when you get a lymph node in the neck presented to your OPD?
So, lymph node in the neck, first we do a.
You ruled out everything,
yeah.
Local lesion, you've examined that so beautifully, all the drainage areas. What do you normally do?
We go for an FNAC.
I'm glad you're speaking the truth. Grand Medical College, like any other medical school. So they will all be asking the same question. And you answered correctly. So when you do an FNAC, it doesn't make a diagnosis of lymphoma. Nobody's saying it should. But it excludes a diagnosis of tuberculosis. The management is totally different. And the fear factor is different. Patients handling, counseling, everything is different. You do an ultrasound, what are the features which suggest malignancy, metastasis in the lymph node, which will be repeated many times, it is not in the past. You do an ultrasound.